Good evening, one and all. Good evening to day 8 session on a lecture series on a role and role of cement and supplementary cementitious materials in production of environment friendly concrete, which is a way forward towards sustainability. On day 8, we have an eminent speaker. So let me introduce the speaker, Mr. Chandrasekhar Reddy Garu. Mr. Chandrasekhar Reddy Garu has a completed his BTech in Civil Engineering and MTech in Structural Engineering from University College of Engineering and Technology, which is affiliated to JNTU Kakinada, Andhra Pradesh. So currently, Chandrasekhar sir has pursuing his PhD from the Vidyan Foundation of Science and Technology and Research, which is a Dibrugarh University in Andhra Pradesh. His area of interest is evaluating the effect of graphene oxide on microstructure and microstructural mechanical and durability properties of cement composite materials. Chandrasekhar Reddy sir has published 3 research papers in international journals and attended 3 international conferences. So it's my immense pleasure to introduce Chandrasekhar sir and having him on this platform. So good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for introducing my profile.
Yes, sir.
At first, I'd like to thank Sri Chaitanya College of Engineering and Technology, Karimnagar, and also the head of the Civil Engineering Department, Dr. Sriramchand Madhuri Garu, for giving me this opportunity. Today, I am going to deliver my presentation on graphene nanotechnology in concrete. So before knowing the graphene nanotechnology, first we need to know about the nanotechnology. So for that, this is the presentation of outline of my topic. So through this outline, what I can deliver means, so first we will learn about the nanotechnology and what are the different types of nanomaterials in order in concrete, and what are the different types of methods of synthesis approaches for the nanomaterials. After that, we will go with the graphene and what is graphene, what is the structure of graphene, and what are the properties and applications of graphene. And finally, we will know about the necessity of graphene in concrete technology. Thereafter, conclusions. So this is an introduction. So what we can know about the introduction means, not all of us, some of us might be having a thought of a construction process is a new science and new technology, but it is not like that, because we are all very familiar with the concept of getting raw materials, bringing them together in an organized way, and then putting them together into a recognizable form. So as an example of a concrete. So this is our role in our society. So we need to have performed it well for hundreds, for thousands of years. So we can say construction is definitely not a new science or technology, and yet it has undergone great changes over its history. So in the same way, nanotechnology is not a new science or not a new technology, just it is extending the or extension of the sciences and technology that have already been in development for many years. Next, when it comes to the nanotechnology, what is nanotechnology? So nanotechnology is nothing but the creation of the large scale materials by the use of small pieces of the materials. So this creation of large scale materials can be done, small scale material can be done in other science of fields such as chemistry, biology, physics, material science, and engineering. And when it comes to the what is nanomaterials, what materials we can call it as a nanometer, means, as we know that conventional materials having a grain size anywhere from 100 micrometer to 1 mm and more, but the particles which are having the size at least one dimension in the ranges, it ranges between 1 to 100 nanometer, are normally regarded as a nanomaterial. So that is the meaning and definition of the nanomaterials. And yet the nanoscale material properties have been altered when compared to the bulk materials, that means larger scale materials. And when it comes to the continuation of the nanotechnology, so nanotechnology can allow us to develop or improve the properties of a new developed technology. And also a nanotechnology depends on the two principal factors. So for enhancing the material properties, so those are increased relative surface area and quantum effects. So these factors can change or enhance the properties such as reactivity, strength, and electrical characteristics when compared to the large scale materials to the nanomaterials. and some fast to visualize nano. That means what is the information can we understand, through which information can we understand the concept of nanotechnology. So for that we have some information, that is a nanometer is a unit of length in the metric system, as we know that. So in that case, it is equal to the 1/1,000,000,000th of a meter, that is equal to the 10^-9 meter. And also another visualizer factor to understand the nano means, a nanometer is about, that means the one nanometer is equal to the width of a 6 bonded carbon atoms. And also in another way also we can understand, your fingernails grow approximately 1 nanometer per second. So another way to visualize a nanometer is also 1 inch equal to 2 crore 54 lakhs nanometers. And also we can observe through red blood cells, you see it is approximately 7000 nanometer in diameter, and also in height it is approximately 2000 nanometer. And also, as we know that a virus is approximately having a size is approximately 100 nanometers. So those are the some variety, that means we have some different factors to visualize the concept of nano. And why nanometers are called so? That means what? That means nanoscale. That means it is the definition of the nanoscale. So nanoscale is nothing but it is the borderline between macro scale and quantum scale. Here you can observe, in the case of macro, the size is greater than 100 nanometer. When it compares to the quantum, the size is less than 1 nanometer. But in the case of nano, the size is ranges from 1 to 100 nanometer. That means 1 to 100 nanometer is not for all dimensions. At least one dimension of the size of any material is in between the 1 to 100 nanometers. In that case, those type of materials is considered as a nano material. In that type of scale considered as a nano scale. So synthesis approach of nanometers. So for making or for preparation of any nanomaterials, there are two methods following. So first one is top down method and second one is bottom up method. So based on the concept involved in these two methods only, the next coming synthesizing processes for making and for preparation of any different types of nanometers involved in this concept only. So in the case of top down method, it involves from bulk materials to nanometer. That means we can create a nanometer from the bulk materials. So that means from the macro scale to nano scale. When it comes to the bottom up method, in the case of bottom up method, from quantum materials to nanometers can be created. That means the scale is in between quantum scale to nano scale. How these will be worked out and the concept how to understand will be, you will understand in the next slides. So here you can observe top-down approach and bottom-up approach. In the case of top-down approach, you can observe creating a nanoscale material by physically or chemically breaking down nanomaterial properties. Assembling, and next in the case of bottom-up approach, assembling materials atom by atom or molecule by molecule. A molecule by molecule, nothing but self-assembly. Sorry for the interruption. So here you can observe in the diagram wise also, that means from the bulk materials, by breaking the bulk materials into nanometers, we can create a nanometer. And also here you can observe by assembling the small size less than the nanometer, we can create a nanomaterial. And this is also another example for the top-down method. Here you can observe the two pictures. In one picture, you can observe the bulk size marble rock. And in the second picture, you can observe the statue. That means from the breaking of this bulk material of marble size rock, we can create a small size nanometer type of statue. That is explained in this case. In this method, nanometals are derived from a bulk substrate and obtained by progressive removal of the material until desired nanometer is obtained. This is also one of the concept explained in the top-down method. And when it comes to the bottom-up method, here also you can observe these two pictures. First picture observe the Leo bricks, and second picture represents the by the assembling of these Leo bricks, we can create some form of structure. So that means here the concept is involved in this case. assembling of macro level size, sorry, quantum level size of materials to create a nanomaterials. So this is the concept involved in the bottom-up method. In this method, nanomaterials are obtained starting from the atomic or molecular precursors and gradually assembling it until the desired structure is formed. And necessity of nanomaterials in concrete. So those are, up to now we have discussed what is nanotechnology and also what are the different types of materials and approaches. So now we are having a interesting topic is necessity of nanomaterials in concrete. Why we need to utilize nanomaterials in concrete? So we will discuss about that one. Nowadays, the demand for multifunction and high performance concrete structures has been raised in the aspect of strength and durability properties. So to meet up the advanced structural challenges, so to fulfill this type of demands, researchers have been concentrated on the carbon-based nanomaterial utilization in cement composite structure, because nanomaterials can directly interact with the bond of the cement particles. So that's why, so there is an importance to introduce these nanomaterials for getting a multifunctional high-performance concrete structures in concrete. These are the different types of applications of nanotechnology. Here in construction materials, nanotechnology can be introduced. That means in concrete, in steel, in wood, in glass, and in coating. So in this way, in different types of construction materials, nanotechnology has also been introduced. So finally, nanotechnology in concrete. So in all of these, mostly we need to think about the concrete. At present also, this topic is also about concrete. That's why I'm going to discuss about only concrete. As we all know that concrete is a mixture of cement, sand, coarse aggregate, and water. But when the nanotechnology is introduced in the concrete, the mechanical behavior of the concrete material depends on the phenomenon that occurs on a micro to nano scale. And also, when the nanotechnology is introduced in the concrete, it can modify the structure of a concrete material and finally improve its properties of materials in the same vein, bulk density, mechanical performance, volume stability, durability, and sustainability of a concrete. So by the modification of the structure of the hydration crystals of a concrete through the introduction of the nanotechnology or nanometals in concrete, these all the possible properties can be enhanced. So these addition could compensate for its weakness in concrete, that is, concrete is weak in tension, and result in concrete with greatly improved stress strain behavior. So what are the different types of nanometals so far used in concrete? Those are three types of nanometals: nanosilicon, nanotitanium oxide, and some carbon-based nanomaterials. So next, when it comes to the nanosilicon, nanosilica is a white fluffy powder composed of high purity amorphous silica powder. And because of its small particle size, that is nothing but, as we know that nanometer ranges from 1 to 100 nanometer. That's why it is also less than 100 nanometer. And nanosilica had the advantages of a large surface area, strong surface absorption, large surface energy, high chemical purity, and good dispersion. These are some advantages properties related to nanosilica. Then particularly, nanosilica is used as a supplementary cementitious material in the manufacturing of paste, mortar, and concrete to offer the production of potential materials with new and interesting properties such as enhanced strength and durability properties. So that's all about this very little information about the nanosilica. Here, mostly I'm giving the very little information about the nanotechnology, but I would like to concentrate totally on the graphene. In the next coming slide, you will see. And when it comes to the nanotitanium oxide, so the titanium oxide nanoparticles are also having the size in diameter less than 100 nanometer, and it is also added to concrete. So after addition of this material to concrete, it improves the properties of the concrete in the manner of increases the hydration. It improves the compressive strength, and also it improves the flexural strength and enhance the abrasion resistance. And next, there are some different types of carbon-based nanometals. What are those means? There are fullerenes, that means that is a zero dimensional nanomaterials. And next one, carbon nanotubes, that is one dimensional nanomaterial. And third one is graphene, that is graphene and its derivatives. We will see what is graphene and its derivative, and that is also a two dimensional nanomaterials. So those are all carbon based nanomaterials are obtained from the naturally occurring carbon contained there. That means high amount of carbon percentage is contained in the graphite track, that is three-dimensional structure. So from that graphite only, all these carbon-based materials can be derived. Is a stacked layer of single layers of graphene. That means graphite has a layered structure of carbon atoms. That means you can observe here, it is having a number of layers, single layers of graphite. That means due to the attachment of top of each other, there is a formation of a stacked layer of graphite rock. So in this stacked layer of a number of layers present in the graphite rock, each isolated layer is called as a graphene. That means you can observe a single layer of graphite is considered as a graphene. That means why the name is considered as a graphene means a single layer of graphite considered as a graphene. That means single represents in graph comes from the graphite. That's why single layer of a graphite is considered as a graphene. That means from here onwards, we will understand graphene means it is a single layer of graphite. Graphite means it is a stacked layers of graphite. That means it is having number of layers. But when we remove a single layer of graphite from the graphite rock, that is considered as a graphene. And next, what is so interesting about graphene? In nowadays, graphene is becoming as a miracle material in 21st century because of its unique properties and its application found in every field of research, nothing but health sciences, medicine, energy, and in various fields of sciences, the potential is unimagined. So in that case, graphene is also represents, it is as the strongest material in the world, and it is stiffer than diamond, thinnest material, and that can be imagined. That means the thinnest means how you imagine here, you can observe the 1 lakh times thinner than human hair. That means one single layer of a graphite, that is nothing but a graphene, is having a thickness 1 lakh times thinner than the human hair. And also it is stretchable up to 20% elastically, so to its initial stage. And also it is having many other properties that can make it as a world miracle materials. Now I am saying it is a world miracle materials. After completion of this PPT, you will also understand why it is world miracle material. A little introduction to the graphene. Graphene can be described as one atom thick layer of graphite, and it is an allotrope of a carbon as like graphite, diamond, and charcoal. That means in the case of graphite, diamond, and charcoal also, you can observe the carbon particle. Like in the graphene also, you can observe the carbon atoms. So that's why it is also one of the allotrope of a carbon. And next, graphene is the strongest and thinnest material known to exist in the world up to now. And graphene is 0.3453 nanometer to 1 nanometer thick. That means single layer of graphene, nothing but the thickness it is having a one atom layer thickness. That means one atom is equal to the 0.3453 nanometer. That means the range of the thickness of the graphene is in between 0.345 nanometer to 1 nanometer thick. And when it comes to the 1 mm, that is equal to the 10 lakh nanometers. And next, when it comes to the history of graphene, sorry for the introduction, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Okay, sir, thank you. So when it comes to the history of graphene, so actually this graphene was discovered by two Russian scientists in the year 2004 in the University of Manchester. Those two scientists named as Andrew Jamin, Konstantin Novoselova. So for their discovery, they got a Nobel Prize in 2010 also. So these are the two members. He is an Andrew Jamin, he is in Konstantin Novoselova. So in the year 2004, these two Russian scientists used a scotch tape and graphite track to discover what means graphene. This is a graphene structure. Here you can observe the hexagonal pattern in the form of honeycomb structure. That means it is a layer of atoms. That means here, these are the carbon atom in hexagonal formation. It is a layer of atoms arranged in a honeycomb structure. And because of these properties, those two sciences consider this graphene material as a groundbreaking material that can change our world. And they also explain why they can consider this material as a groundbreaking material. Here also we will know why it is, because graphene is the thinnest known material, only one atom thick, as all of these properties were found by and were discovered by those two scientists only. So in this case, graphene is the thinnest known material and also only one atom thick. Here you can observe it would take 3 million steckles of single layer of graphene. That means 3 million steckle layers of one single layer of graphene. If you consider those are 3 million steckle layers of one single layers of graphene, is equal to the width of a single pencil tip. That is unimaginable. So that means here it is. You can understand what it is. And also they found this is a lightest material. So and also they found this is a very strongest material. That means, so it is harder than diamond, and it is stronger than, that means 200 times stronger than steel. All of these properties were found by those two scientists only. And also it conducts electricity and heat better than any other material. And also it allows nothing to pass through it except water. There you can observe how the thinnest and lightest and the holes which are present in the honeycomb structure, how the diameter of those holes, you can understand. That means it cannot allows even helium atoms also. That means based on this information, how can the unique qualities of all of these qualities of this graphene can help the world right now we are living in. Let's see. That means here in future we can imagine the application of graphene in flexible cell phones, and also we can imagine the application of graphene in wallpaper type TVs. That means these wallpaper type TVs with the application of graphene, we could roll up and take it with you. So in future, if you apply a graphene technology in these electronic fields. And also due to the application of graphene, a standard size batteries that hold a larger charge is possible. And also a smaller computer chips leading to faster electronics is also possible due to the application of graphene. And in the case of aircraft also, for the lighter structure and for the stronger structure, and through that lighter, even though through lighter and stronger, so it can utilize the less fuel. So for this possibility also, there is an application of graphene is needs to be done. And also graphene is having one of the important property. It is having a superconductivity. Due to its superconductivity, a graphene could play a huge part in the future of solar power also. As we can say here, a standard size of batteries is also possible to hold the largest, longer charge due to the application of graphene. So it is helpful in the case of electric cars for the revolutionizing the electric cars by enhancing their battery's capacity and making them more efficient and eventually more affordable. And in the case of anti-corrosion part also, so graphene has proven to be an anti-corrosion coating for metals. That is trans, in that case, that metals can become a transparent, thinner and longer lasting than anything which are currently exist. And it is also one of the important future technologies can be possible with the help of graphene application is future of clean drinking water is possible with the graphene nanotechnology only. So here is why you will know graphene's ability to let nothing. This is only because of this property. Graphene cannot allow even helium atoms also. Only it can allow water molecules. So because of that property, so it is possible to graphene ability to let nothing pass through it except water makes it the world's greatest filter. Here you will see how it is. Here you can observe the graphene single layer member. So when the seawater is passed through the single layer of graphene, this graphene structure is having a very small tiny holes. So due to that tiny holes, the salt particles can be retained on that membranes, graphene membranes. So in that case, it can allow only water molecules. So in that case, for the thirsty population, it is possible to provide a drinking water with the help of sea water also. So that's all about the very vast and useful application and useful qualities of those graphene. So next we will enter into the structure of a graphene. What is the structure of a graphene? So it is a two-dimensional nanomaterial, and it is having, and it is atomically a thick layer of carbon, and also it is having a low specific surface area, high Young's modulus, high thermal conductivity, and excellent electrical conductivity. Due to these properties, make the graphene as the one of the most prominent nanometal for applications in concrete. That means these properties can help to utilize this graphene nanotechnology in concrete. And is also, it was formed with the one atom layer thickness. One atom means it is equal to the 0.345 nanometer, as I said in the earlier slides. And the structure is to formed as honeycomb by the lattice formation. And the graphene is a very lightest, thinnest material, and also it is the strongest material ever. It is hotter than diamond and 200 times stronger than steel. And also graphene is formed with the combination of number of carbon atoms positioned in a hexagonal design. So then these carbon atoms are bonded to each other. The bond between, the bonding between those carbon atoms is considered as a covalent bond. And also by stacking of these layers of single layer of graphene on top of each other will create a three-dimensional graphite crystal is formed. That means from one part of a graphene, two-dimensional graphene layer, we can take the some part of the graphene layer, we can make it as a, we can wrap it into a zero-dimensional polarize, and also that part of a graphene layer, we can take it out and we can make it as a rolled into a one-dimensional nanotubes or stacked into a three-dimensional graphite, because this graphene is nothing else than a single layer graphite. Here you can see zero-dimensional fullerenes, one-dimensional carbon nanotubes, two-dimensional graphene. That means from this two-dimensional graphene, by taking any part of this two-dimensional graphene particle, we can create a one-dimensional carbon nanotubes and the zero-dimensional fullerenes. And also by stacking this two-dimensional nanometal on top of each other, we can create a three-dimensional graphite. Here you can see how it is possible. That means from this part, any part of this two-dimensional nanometer, we can create zero-dimensional nanometers in this way. We can create a one-dimensional nanometer in this way, and we can create a three-dimensional graphite material in this way. And also there are some certain properties of wide varieties of very useful properties of graphene in different fields. So what are those fields means? In chemical properties, in electronic properties, in mechanical properties and thermal properties and optical properties. Now we will see what are the properties that graphene can be represented. In the case of chemical properties, graphene is a chemically the most reactive form of a carbon, in which each single atom is exposed for a chemical reaction from the two sides, because it is a two-dimensional material. That means in the two sides of the two-dimensional nanometer of a graphene, so each carbon atom can react with another material. And also graphene burns at very low temperature, 350 degrees centigrade. And also graphene has the highest ratio of edgy carbons in comparison with similar materials such as carbon nanotubes, as you can see in the slides. And also graphene is commonly modified with oxygen and nitrogen containing functional groups. When it comes to the electronic property, it is a zero overlap semi-metal with a very high electrical conductivity. And also it represents the electrons are able to flow through graphene are more easily than through even copper. That means due to the structure of two-dimensional structure and honeycomb structure, it is possible to the flow of graphene without having any obstruction easily even than copper also. And it also exhibits high charge carrier mobility. When it comes to the mechanical property, actually to derive the strength of the graphene, we need to perform the atomic force microscopy. After performing that a technique, we will understand the strength of the graphene is harder than diamond and 200 times stronger than the steel, and it represents the tensile strength of graphene exceeds up to 1 TPa, and it is stretchable up, as we known in the earlier slides, it is stretchable up to 20% of its initial strength. And when it comes to the thermal property, graphene represents it is a perfect thermal conductor, and its thermal conductivity is much higher than all other carbon structures, as carbon nanotubes, graphite, and diamond at room temperature. And when it comes to the graphite, that means when we compare the thermal properties with the graphene and graphite, the three-dimensional version of graphene is nothing but graphite. So its thermal conductivity is about 5 times lesser. That means 5 times smaller. And next, when it comes to the ballistic thermal conductance of graphene is isotropic. That is, the thermal conductivity is possible is same in all direction in the case of graphene. And when it comes to the optical property, even though graphene is only a one atom thickness, it still it is visible to the naked eye. And due to its unique electrical properties, it absorbs a high 2.3% of light that passes through it. So because of these properties, we can say, or you can also say, might be it's a wonder material that could revolutionize the world. And finally, when we still now we have discussed about the graphene introduction, what are those properties? So like that, now we are going to enter into the another topic, that is types of graphene. Actually, single layer of graphite is considered as a graphene. Actually, this single layer of graphite, nothing but graphene production, is one of the costliest and time-taking process. That's why, hence, scientists were concentrated on the production of the alternatives or derivatives of a graphene from graphite flakes in larger quantities. Those are nothing but graphene oxide, graphene nanoplatelets, and reduced graphene oxide. So here you can observe what is graphene oxide. So graphene oxide is nothing but it is a compound of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen molecules. It is artificially created by following the Hummer's method. It is a standard method to create and to prepare graphene oxide. In that method, we can create the graphene oxide by artificially treating the graphite with strong oxidizers such as a concentrated sulfuric acid, potassium permanganate, sodium nitrate, hydrogen peroxide, hydrochloric acid, and distilled water, which were all analytical grade were considered in the case of preparation of the graphene oxide. And also after the preparation of graphene oxide, the graphene oxide layers produced a thickness of about in between the 1.5 to 2 nanometer thickness per single layer of graphene oxide nanotube. Here you need to observe one thing. A single layer of graphite is considered as a graphene. Graphene is nothing but it is a one-atom layer thickness. One-atom layer thickness is nothing but that is equal to 0.345 nanometer. Here you can observe a single layer of graphene nanotubes is equal to the thickness of 1.5 to 2 nanometer. That means a few layers of graphene layers are stacked one on top of each other. In that case, the graphene oxide nanometers is formed. That means in the case of graphene oxide nanomaterial, a single layer of graphite is not possible because there is a formation of few layers of graphite. That means that's why few layers of graphite means a single layer of graphene is equal to 0.345 nanometer. So by the multiplication of some few layers, you will get the thickness of 1.5 to 2 nanometer. So that is the difference. You need to understand the difference between graphene and graphene oxide. Graphene is nothing but single layer. Graphite is nothing but it is a few layers of graphite. Few layers of graphite. Single layer of graphite is nothing but graphene. Few layers of graphite is nothing but graphene oxide. Because why it could become as a few layers? Formation of and preparation of single layer is not an easy process. It takes time, a lot of time. It is also a costly process. That's why researchers were concentrated on this type of graphene derivatives of graphene. And next, when it comes to the graphene nanoplatelets, here you can observe the thickness of the single layer of the graphene nanoplatelets is range between the 5 to 50 nanometers range, and the size is up to 50 microns. That means here you need to observe the difference between graphene oxide and graphene nanoplatelets. When compared to the graphene oxide, the layers, that means few layers in the graphene oxide single layer of nanosheet, here there are more number of graphite layers are there when compared to the graphene oxide. That means that's why the thickness has been increased. And also when it comes to the reduced graphene oxide, that means the thickness of this reduced graphene oxide is much more nearer to the single layer of graphene. But for the preparation of this graphene oxide, compulsory we need to first prepare the graphene oxide. So because how it reduces the graphene oxide prepared means here you can have to the reduced. That means what we can reduce in the graphene oxide after the preparation of the graphene oxide on the structure of the graphene oxide. Here you can observe the graphene structure. This is the graphene oxide structure. Here you can observe the on the structure of the graphene oxide structure, some carboxyl and carbonyl groups, which means those are oxygen functional group on the edges. On the planes of the graphene oxide structure, you can observe the epoxyl and hydroxyl groups. So by the reduction of the oxygen functional groups on which are on the graphene oxide, we can prepare the reduced graphene oxide. That's why it is called as a reduced graphene oxide. Here you can observe the difference between structure and also oxygen molecule, which are oxygen functional groups, which are presented in the case of graphene oxide and reduced graphene oxide. Here you can observe the in the case of graphene nanoplatelets, the number of single layer graphite layers are more when compared to the graphite oxide and graphene also. That's why the thickness is higher when compared to the single layer of graphene and also single layer of graphene oxide nanosheets. So here you can observe the a few single layer of graphene is possible to produce in the case of laboratory is only, but in the case of industrial wise to produce any type of graphene is possible in the form of few layers or in the form of graphene nanoplatelets only, because it is a highly costless and time taking process. It takes very vast time. That's why it is possible to produce in industrial wise a few layer graphene, nothing but a graphene oxide and reduced graphene oxide and graphene nanoplatelets. Here we can observe one layer graphene is nothing but number of layers which are presented in the graphene, one layer graphene, only one. In the case of two layer graphene, number of layers presented are two layers. When it comes to the few layer graphene, the number of layers means what are those layers means a single layer of graphite layers. That means those are ranged from 3 to 10 number of layers. So those type of layers considered as a few layer graphene. And in the case of graphene nanoplatelets, as I said in the earlier, because the thickness has been increased because of this reason only, the layers are ranged from 11 to 3000. And in the case of graphite, as we know that graphite is having number of stacked layers, it is having more than 3000 plus number of layers. So that's all about that graphene and the structure and also what are the different types of graphene. And next we are going to discuss about the synthesizer of graphene. So for the synthesizing of this graphene and also its derivative like few layers of graphene and also single layer of graphene is possible with the three methods. These are chemical vapor deposition method and mechanical exfoliation. And also third one is mechanical cleavage from natural graphite. From these two methods, chemical vapor deposition, mechanical exfoliation, a single layer formation of graphite, that is nothing but a purely one atom thick layer of graphene is possible to produce with these two methods only. But with this method, we can create a few layers of graphene. Derivative is nothing but graphene oxide and graphene nanoplatelets and reduced graphene oxide. So what you can observe in the chemical vapor deposition, here you need to observe this is a vacuum chamber. In the case of vacuum chamber, we need to arrange one substrate is nothing but can be considered as a nickel or copper material. So in that case some gases are entered into this vacuum chamber. Some gases are nothing but methane gas is nothing but formed as CH4. In that case, one carbon atom, four surrounded by the four hydrogen atoms. So in this case also, there is a carbon atom, but through this procedure, here we are not utilizing the graphite material to produce a graphene layer. We are utilizing the gaseous molecules which are having the carbon particle. So in the carbon atoms, so through that procedure, through those gaseous molecules only, here we are going to prepare a graphene single layer material. That's why it is considered as a chemical vapor deposition method. And in this case, after the entering of the gaseous molecules, that here it is heated, that material is heated. So when it is heated, to certain temperature, the molecules, that means the carbon atoms which are in the methane gas, which are removed from the hydrogen atom, then those are stacked onto the copper layer. So thereafter, those carbon atoms are arranged atom by atom to the formation of a honeycomb structure of a single layer of graphene. So after that, that layer of single layer of graphene can be removed from that copper metal. So this is a standard procedure to form a single layer of graphene through a chemical vapor deposition method. And also some advantages by this way, chemical vapor deposition method means it is high purity and high quality impervious, and also harder graphene is obtained if you prepare a graphene through this method, and also producing large domains of graphene is easy processing, and also high growth rate is possible through this method, and it can produce a good reproducibility of a graphene layer. And when it comes to the mechanical exfoliation, in this case, to produce the single layer of graphene, the scientists were utilized one graphite track along with the help of adhesive scotch tape material. So in this here, you can observe the scotch tape material from the adhesive side of the scotch tape. So this adhesive side of the scotch tape is laid on the graphite track. Thereafter that a tape is peeled off from that graphite rock. So in that case, the graphite layers are stacked to that adhesive side of the tape material. So thereafter, that adhesive side is overlapped with the clean adhesive side of the tape. So in that way, that is a continuation process. That means attaching this graphene layer materials to the non-attaching graphene materials. So after that, there is a formation of single layer graphene material is possible through this process also. Next, that which is attached to that adhesive side of the tape nanomaterial is removed with the help of some substrate like silica. Here you can observe silica or SiO2 vapors. So in that way, a mechanical exfoliation is possible for the preparation of the single layer of graphene. So what are the some advantages are involving in the case of a mechanical exfoliation? Also, those are safe and simple process. A few layer graphene can be easily obtained through this process, and the changes of impurity in the graphene production of graphene is less, and sample preparation is also very simplified method. And when it comes to the preparation of a few layers of graphene, that is nothing but a graphene oxide, reduced graphene oxide. Here it is a following of standard method, that is Hammer's method. I have discussed in the previous slides. So in the Hammer's method, it is used for the producing of graphene. That means for the production of reduced graphene oxide, that is nothing but that is nearer to the single layer of graphene. For that also, we need to prepare a graphene oxide. The preparation of graphene oxide is also possible with the help of by following the Hammer's method. Thereafter, preparation of the graphene oxide by the reduction of the oxygen content, that means oxygen function group, which are laid on the structure of the graphene oxide, we can get the reduced graphene oxide. That's why here it is representing the Hammer's method is used for producing graphene by oxidizing a graphite to graphene oxide by using some suitable oxidizing agents, nothing but KMnO4, HCl4, NaNO3, as I said in the earlier slide. So next, the graphene oxide is so produced is gained, then chemically reduced to get graphene. And next, the Hammer's method to introduce is a way to get a more stable graphene oxide colloidal solution. And also for the dispersion of the number of layers, that means number of few layers in the case of graphene oxide, we need to go with the help of ultrasonication. This ultrasonication is used for stabilizing the graphene oxide solution and enhancing the exfoliation of the graphene oxide solution. Here you can observe from the help of graphite, but that means by treating of this graphite with the strong oxidizers, we can get a graphene oxide. On this graphene oxide, there are some functional groups as you can see in the previous slides. So with those functional groups, a few layers of graphene sheets are formed, that is nothing but graphene oxide. So by reducing the functional groups which are laid on these graphene oxide sheets, we can get a reduced graphene oxide. So this is possible in this way. So Geo represents graphene oxide, R Geo represents reduced graphene oxide. And also there is one important advantage with the help of Ammer's method. Also there is a possibility to the production of high yield and also scalable to the production in industrial level through this method in the case of few layers of graphene oxide and reduced graphene oxide. So finally, we are entering into the applications of a graphene. That means in which type of fields and in what variety of fields graphene is having. That means it is also having wide variety of application. Let's see what are those. First, in the case of biomedical, graphene could soon be used to analyze the DNA structure. That means to record a breaking phase. In the case of biomedical structure, may this graphene can record the DNA structure. So in that case, in US, one physicist was claimed that a reading of the sequence of a chemical bases in a DNA is possible by sending the molecule through a tiny slit. Slit is nothing but a small hole in a graphene sheet. That means through the tiny slit, that means small holes presented in the graphene sheet, it is possible to apply the graphene nanotechnology in the case of biomedical to read the and to analyze the DNA structure. And in the case of integrated circuits, a graphene has a high carrier mobility as well as a low noise, allowing it to be used the channel in the field of effect as transistor. Actually, this all information is not familiar to us. So because of these applications are there with the help of graphene various applications also. That's why I'm giving you very little informations about all of these informations. Okay, if you want to know more about this, you can go through the Google it. Next, processes using 100 gigahertz transistors and 2-inch graphene sheets is also possible. Graphene based handled frequencies is possible up to 100 gigahertz. And in the case of optical electronics at a field, as so graphene is having a high electrical conductivity and high optical transparency makes it as a candidate for transparent conducting electrodes in the case of optical electronics field also. And also the next one is graphene's mechanical strength and flexibility are advantages compared to the indium tin oxide, which is brittle. And also, so it would work very well in optoelectronic touch screens. That means due to the flexibility property of, that means due to the thinnest property of the graphene material, it is possible to have a very well in optoelectronic touch screens. Liquid crystal display, nothing but liquid LED TVs, nothing LED TVs, that is possible to in the case of optical electronics, and also organic photovoltaic cells, and also in the case of organic light emitting and diodes is also possible to have an application of graphene nanotechnology in the case of optical electronics also. And when it comes to the filters, already we have discussed about the filtering concept, that means desalination of water, desalination of seawater with the help of single layer of graphene. So that is also here it is explained by very precise control over the size of the holes. That means very, very tiny cells which are involved in the structure of honeycomb structure of a graphene. It is possible to utilize in the case of filters, as graphene oxide filters could outperform other techniques of desalination by a significant margin. That means here it is, we are having a very greater advantage when compared to the reverse osmosis RO filters also. That means rather than RO filters, we can get a maximum percentage of reduction of the salt particles or impurity particles from the water in the case of drinking water with the help of a single layer of graphene membrane. And also ethanol distillation, graphene oxide membranes allow water vapor to pass through it, but are impermeable to another liquids and gases, as I said in the earlier slides. And also such membranes could revolutionize the economics of a biofuel production and also the alcoholic beverages industry also. These are having some applications of graphene nanotechnology. And in the case of solar cell, graphene turned to be a promising material for photoelectrochemical energy conversion in dye sensitized solar cell. And in the case of transparent, conductive and ultra-thin graphene films are fabricated from exfoliated graphite oxide, followed by thermal reduction. And next, the obtained film exhibits a high conductivity and a transparency of more than 70% in the case of solar cells. And when it comes to the energy storage devices, as we know that it can, the graphene application is having a standard size batteries for the holding the larger time. Due to the extremely high surface area to mass ratio of graphene, one potential application is in the conductive plates of supercapacitors. And also it is believed that graphene could be used to produce supercapacitors with a greater energy storage density than currently available materials. And in the case of it is having an application in the case of antibacterial also. What are those? Let's see, in 2010, the Chinese Academy of Sciences has found that sheet of graphene oxide are highly effective at killing bacteria. The name of that bacteria is such as Escherichia coli. And next, this means a graphene could be useful in applications such as hygiene products or packaging that will help to keep the food in a fresh mode for longer periods of time. And finally, we have entered into the necessity of graphene oxide addition in concrete. Here I have considered the only graphene oxide in among the graphene derivatives. Why I have considered in my research, and also I have done my research due to the addition of graphene oxide. That means I have performed the mechanical microcrystalline durability properties due to the addition of graphene oxide only. Why I have considered only graphene oxide means graphene oxide. The production of graphene oxide is very easy and a very cheapest method, and we can get, in the case of graphene oxide, a few layers of graphene. It is better to produce rather than the single layers of graphene. It is also one of the important property, and it is also exhibits some excellent strength and also durability properties. In this, due to those properties, I have considered the graphene oxide as one of the research area to my PhD work. And let's see. So finally, we will enter into the why graphene oxide is needed in the case of concrete. As we all are aware of that, concrete has been suffering with the brittleness property. Why this brittleness has been occurred in the concrete means due to the formation of hydration crystals in the needle-like and rod-like formations. So due to that formation, the gap is formed in between those hydration crystals that leads to the formation of brittleness problem. So to avoid that brittleness problem, and also to reduce the weakness of the concrete in the case of flexural strength, there are some different types of fibers has been utilized in the case of concrete to improve the strength of the that means to improve the toughness of the concrete, like metal bar, steel fibers, carbon fibers, polymer fibers, and mineral fibers. But all of these differences were concentrated on the type of materials to utilize and also to strengthen the concrete in the case of flexural strength only. But only few studies were concentrated on the modification of the microstructure of the cement composition, nothing but microstructure modification of the hydration crystals which are included in the cement composition is not a concentrated very much percentage. That's why it can significantly, so if you concentrate on the modification of the hydration crystals which are present in the cement composite, it is possible to get a significant enhancement in the case of toughness of the hardened cement composite, and it is also nowadays well worth considering technique. So to improve the toughness of the cement composite, so by modifying the microstructure, one of the nanomaterials, carbon nanomaterials, was considered as, that is found as graphene oxide. So graphene oxide is generally, it is synthesized from a less fine to a graphite powder in huge quantities by Hammer's method. As I said, the Hammer's method introduction, and also what are the different materials used in the Hammer's method. And it is also a layered nanomaterial consisting hydroxyl and epoxyl functional groups on their planes, and the graphene oxide nanosheets having a carbonyl and carboxyl groups positioned on the sheet edges. As you can see in the earlier slides, the structure of the graphene oxide. So it is having high specific surface area, high huge, that means huge aspect ratio, and oxygen functional groups are advantage for the cement hydration crystals to resolve the problem of cement decomposition. This is also one of the advantages. In the case of graphene oxide only, you can observe the oxygen function groups. So because of the involvement of these oxygen function groups, there is a possibility to the highly increased hydration with the help of with the materials which are presented in the cement composite. That means with the box compounds, and these oxygen functional groups can react fastly and rapidly. Due to that reaction, there is a formation of accelerated hydration is possible. That's why one of the reason to the consideration of graphene oxide in my research also. So this is the method of preparation of the graphene oxide by following the Hummer's method. So after the preparation of the graphene oxide, to know is the graphene oxide is formed or not, here it is one example. So after completion of the preparation of the graphene oxide by following the standard method, we can get a bright yellow color to that solution. So in that case, that bright yellow color of that graphene oxide solution represents the formation of graphene oxide. Here you can observe the process of graphene oxide preparation. So it was done in my research work. Here you can observe the bright yellow color to the formation of, that means completion of the graphene oxide preparation to the graphene oxide solution. This represents, it is formed, that means it, this that indicates, yes, here the graphene oxide is formed like that. And also when it comes to structural characterization of a graphene oxide, so it is done to determine the structural characterization of graphene oxide nanosheets is possible with the help of SEM and EDS. So if you observe in the case of chemical composition is done by the EDS method. Here you can observe the highest percentage of carbon is in the case of graphite. So this graphite is treated by this some strong oxidizers. Thereafter, graphene oxide is formed. In the case of graphene oxide, chemical composition is in between. It is having carbon 66.41%. Due to that strong utilization of strong oxidizers, oxygen is content is more when it compared to the graphite, that is 28.95%. In this way, the SEM image represents the wrinkle morphology of the graphene oxide nanosheet. This wrinkle morphology with a high specific area can be helpful to create a strong bond between cement particles and graphene nanosheets. So that is the importance of wrinkle morphology, which can be observed in the case of SEM image can be helpful to create a strong bond between the oxygen functional group, which are in the graphene oxide nanosheets, and also the cement particles, which are presented in the cement composite. So up to now, we have discussed all the things related to the graphene oxide in concrete. Due to that, we will discuss about the some advantages related to graphene. It is the thinnest material known, and with that also it is the strongest. All of these points have been discussed in the earlier slide. I will read out a fast view. So it consists of a single layer of carbon atoms, and it is both pliable and transparent. It is a super conductor of both heat and air. That means these are all the advantages of graphene. It is a super conductor of both heat and electricity, and also it is used in the production of high speed electronic devices, are responsible for fast technological changes, and also given advantages in the case of chemical sensors effective at detecting the explosives. So, and it is also a transistors that operate at higher frequency as compared to the others, and it has led to the production of lower cost of display screens in the case of mobile devices by replacing indium based electrodes in organic light emitting diodes, OLEDs, which also lower power consumption. And in the case of advantage of graphene, used in the production of lithium ion batteries, that means this graphene is also used in the lithium ion batteries that recharge faster. That means in the case of lithium ion battery, where the graphene is utilized, means in the case of anode surface, this graphene material is utilized in the case of lithium ion batteries to get a more time charge and also to recharge faster. And also it is a low cost water desalination is possible by using the graphene membrane. So up to now we have known some information about the graphene and graphene graphene applications and graphene properties and what are the derivatives of graphene and in concrete. So most of the research stated that this wonder material could revolutionize the tech industry. But why graphene has not taken over the field of technology yet? So because there are certain limitations to this graphene also. Let's see what are those. A single sheet of graphene is hard to produce and production cost is also high. And also the second one is there is no such industrial method for the synthesis of graphene oxide in an industrial level, so which prevents its commercialization also. And the main disadvantage of graphene is acting as a catalyst. So due to its catalyst property, it is susceptibility to oxidative environments. And in the case of due to its catalytic property, it affects the metal in battery, and then it needs some chemical modification also. So the new fabrication and manufacturing methods has to be evolved for normal use in electronics also needs to be done in the case of graphene and nanotechnology. And also due to small voltage gain, practical use is limited. That means that is one of the disadvantage or limitation of the graphene. Due to small voltage gain, practical use is limited in nowadays. And also another one important is being a great conductor of electricity, the flow of electrons is continuously flowing without getting any absorption. That is the one of the limitations, because of flow of electrons, although it doesn't have any band gap, that means it can't be switched up. That means the flow of electrons is not possible to switch up. This is one of the limitations. That's why scientists are working on this limitation to rectify this. And last one is research has proven that graphene exhibits some toxic qualities also. So that's why all of these, some of the and few of the limitations and advantages up to now what we have done in the research, because there are just a few of the wonder materials advantages and limitations. Since the material is still in the research stage, much more is to be revealed. That means through these advantages and limitations, you can observe the concept of graphene nanotechnology is in the case of a starting stage and initial stage only. That means there is a much more chance to do a research in the case of graphene nanotechnology in the wide variety of applications. So when it comes to the conclusion, graphene as newly born material has great potential in various fields. The uses of graphene in coming years will give tremendous difference to current technologies. Like any other newly rose material in the world, graphene is also has its own drawbacks and downsides and dark side, but advantages are more. That means advantages are far greater than the drawbacks could affect them. So because of those advantages only, there is a possibility to apply this graphene in very, very wide applications. That means in very wide different types of fields also, not only in concrete. It is having a very wide application as you can see in the different slides. So these are the publications of my research work. I have done, as I said to you, I have done my work on the effect of graphene oxide microstructure, mechanical and durability properties. These are the three international general properties. If you want more information about the effect of graphene oxide on the mechanical, microstructure and durability properties, you can go through these research papers of mine. You will understand the concept of graphene oxide on the cement composites. So we have discussed much more information about the about graphene, and also have said and also you have listened. So will graphene bring a revolutionary change in the tech field? But from my side, I can say a big yes, because of the all of this information, what I have known and what I have said, based on those information, I can say yes. And also I strongly believe this material may rule the world in the future. And what you think, what you believe, you can give in the chat box. And also for having more information about graphene, you can visit www.graphene-info.com. And also recently one update was come in the case of graphene based concrete used in a commercial setting for the first time. That means it is the article recently, an article May 26, 2021. That means for laying the concrete slab, for getting a sustainability in its commercial setting. So with the collaboration of Manchester University, one construction company that is nationwide engineering company is collaborated with the Manchester University. Because why only Manchester University in the UK? Because the invention or discovery of the graphene was done. Two scientists are related to our University of Manchester only. That's why this construction company is collaborated with Manchester University to create a graphene-based concrete and utilized in the case of for laying the setting for the commercial setting of a slab. So that's all about the recent information about the graphene. If you want more information, you can go through this website. There you will understand what is graphene from each and everything, from the starting to the invention of the graphene up to now. Let me say, in the case of technology in the 2021 also, you will see in that graphene website. So thank you for your attention, and also any questions if you have, you can ask me. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Chandrasekhar Reddy sir. It's a very informative session. Really, I think this graphene will be going to rule the entire universe in the upcoming days.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. There are a few questions in the chat box. Sir, what is the usual temperature of heating carbon molecules in a vacuum chamber?
In vacuum chamber, sir?
Yes, sir.
Actually, that is indeed. Actually, I have shared only very little information. In detail one, I didn't go through there because that is a vast process. That's why I could not represent in that. So that is also not known to me.
What is the effect on light? When it passes through graphene,
light.
Yeah, when light passes through graphene, then what will be the effect? Is there any effect or not? He is asking it.
So actually, I have shared an information while the session is going on. Also, I have shared an information. I have known the information only in the concept of concrete only. Even though more than the concrete, I have said in other fields also. But if you have any question related to graphene, that means in the case of concrete only, I can give an answer. Otherwise, I don't know, sir.
Yes, sir. What is
just share an information if you have an interest. That's yes, sir.
What is fullerene zero dimensional? If yes, how it is possible as zero indication, no existence? Vishal, can you please unmute yourself and ask the question exactly? Vishal? Yes, Vishal, can you please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I have known from the presentation that fullerene is a zero dimensional field. So, as zero indicates, that means if anything is zero, generally it would indicate that there is no existence of zero. So, can I know how is it possible for zero-dimensional fullerene to be exist, sir?
Yeah, Vishal, I can answer for your question. The thing is, zero-dimensional means if you know that every material is three-dimensional, X, Y, and Z.
Yes, sir.
If all the three dimensions are having nano size, then it is referred as zero dimensional. Why? Because it is very smaller. So if two dimensional, very small, that is nanometers, and one dimensional is with respect to length, then it is one dimensional. So it means that zero dimensional means the material is existing, but all the three dimensions are of nano size.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. That is the right.
Sir, can I know the meaning of surface adsorption?
Surface adsorption is nothing but if you consider the graphene oxide or graphene nanometer, it is having one of the properties. It is hydrophilic properties. In that case, it can absorb more water when utilized in the case of graphite also. That means that represents the surface adsorption property.
Okay. Thank you so much for answering, sir.
Thank you very much for giving me question.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So Raju sir.
Yeah, before Raju sir is going to conclude, here one last question from Tejasri. Is graphene affect the human body? Chandrasekhar?
Sir, yes sir, there is already in the limitations I have mentioned one point, there is a toxicity is possible. That means it has been proved in through research that there is a toxicity is possible, not only through graphene oxide, through any type of nanomaterial there is a possibility of toxicity. So that means if you don't take a proper preventive measures while preparation and utilization of any type of nanomaterial, there is a formation, that means there is some can affect in our cells, that means in our blood cells, with those entering of those nanomaterials is possible, sir. That has been proved with by some researchers that is a toxic material also. That means we need to take care when the utilization and preparation also any type of nanomaterial.
So you mean to say that as the particles are nanosized, we may inhale?
We may inhale through our nose or mouth if you don't take a preventive measures while doing this.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And I request my coordinator and my concerned faculty, Raju sir.